What a privilege. What an awesome privilege it is to be again in the house of the Lord on this another beautiful Sabbath day. There is a special greeting that we have that we share with each one, and it says, Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. For those who are joining us on the platforms that we're on, when we say Happy Sabbath, that is just saying we are so pleased that God has blessed us with another beautiful Sabbath day, and we are so excited, so happy to be in His courts to praise and to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And so we welcome you on behalf of our pastors. We want to welcome you to the Belvedere Seventh Adventist Church's worship service, a worship experience that is unique, one that you will not find anywhere else. And so as we worship God today, I know that He will speak directly into your concerns, that He will encourage you in your walk with Him, and that as we leave this place, as we finish our worship service today, that we will be transformed. So again, welcome. Welcome to the Belvedere Seventh-day Adventist Church's worship service. The scripture tells us that we should remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day, that day that has been set aside, sanctified, that day is holy unto the Lord. So let us worship. Let us worship in spirit and in truth. Oh, magnify. Magnify the Lord with me, will you? And let us exalt His name together. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity that you have given us, again to be in your house of prayer, your house of worship, a place that you have designated for us to assemble. God, we thank you. We thank you for all who will join us on the platforms, God, that we're on today. We know that you will touch our lives in a special way. Bless us this end, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. It is now time for us to join in our praise and worship, where we lift our hearts and our voices in praise to God. So let us sing along with Sister Lois as she leads out.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I thank the Lord for today, Sabbath, and also for seeing another year and another birthday. And I appreciate those who have already wished me well. This morning, our praise and worship is dedicated in consecration. Our first song will be page 308, Holy Thine. Our second song will be Take My Life, page 330. And our third song will be page 317, Lead Me to Calvary. So you guys sing heartily, because you know this is our regular weekly dose of medicine to get us going through the next week. Is that right? Amen.
Teach me how, teach me how.
over to page 330, Take My Life and Let It Be. Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Turn over to page 317. Lead me to Calvary. 317. Lest I forget. King of my life, I crown thee. It's time for us to turn our eyes upon Jesus, to look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Just sung about it. We have meditated upon what it means to us to really see Jesus. I invite you now to take all your concerns and all your cares, and as the scripture says, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. We believe that. Join me now as we touch the throne of grace, asking God for mercy. We shall kneel as far as is possible. Assume a posture of reverence as we touch God's throne. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we are very humbled in your presence. We recognize that there is none like you. No one can dictate to you. No one can change your plans. No one can second guess you. We are your children. We are your creatures, made by your almighty hands. And Lord, we just thank you for the privilege of prayer. We thank you, God, that you have provided for us a channel whereby we can connect with you and communicate with you. The heathen gods don't communicate this way. You're a God who loves us supremely. You come seeking after man, other gods. Man has to struggle to find, but you have presented yourself. We see your expression upon the petals of the flowers. We see your goodness each and every day. Just to be alive, Lord, we thank you, because we don't deserve it. Each one of us, we deserve to die, because the wages of sin is death. We have all sinned and come short. But even when we are in our rebellion, the sacrifice is made. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the blood. This morning, Heavenly Father, we pray that you don't treat us like we treat others, O God. We pray that you will continue to have mercy upon us and help us, God, to be transformed after your likeness so that we can have mercy upon others. Today we come before you with many burdens, many concerns, many cares. We are sometimes anxious, Lord, but we pray that you will give us faith to trust you and to hold on to your promises, knowing that you, the one who has promised, you are able also to perform. We are facing one of the most challenging times of Earth's history. Wars on every side and rumors of wars everywhere. Earthquakes devastating the land. There are skirmishes around every corner. The heart of mankind has become so hardened, Lord, we are callous one with another. But we just thank you that there is still a people. And you have gathered them here today in your house, a house of prayer for all people. We have come because we see the need to be different, to be changed. And we know that there is power in the blood still. So today we ask for the transformation. Take every person here today. We are in your house for a reason. We don't believe this is by accident. You have designed it for us to be here. And so we pray that you will grant unto us the blessing, the forgiveness, the restoration that we all stand in need of. We present before you the specific needs, Lord, for healing. We pray, Lord, that you will heal us physically, heal us emotionally, heal us spiritually, O God. Set your people right again. Give us that vision for mission, because you have called us in these end times to preach the everlasting gospel, the gospel of love, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us to love you supremely and to love each other. And help us, Lord, that we will connect with one another for the purpose of influencing someone for the kingdom. We present the Belvedere Church and its programs and plans. We ask that you will help us to keep the focus. Help us never to lose sight of you in everything we do. Help us not to work for aggrandizement or for praise, but to glorify your name. In our worship today, we invite, O God, that we will have the spirit of true worship, that we will look to you. Help us, Lord, not to seek entertainment or self-satisfaction, but that we will seek for you to pour out your Holy Spirit in this place. May there be the mighty rushing wind to occupy this place, O God. We pray that you will go beyond just the walls of this building, but that you will enter every heart and help us to be a powerful force to be reckoned with in this community. We pray, Heavenly Father, for the speaker of the hour. We ask that you will take Dr. McLean in hand, that you will do a work upon him, the likes of which he has never experienced before. Touch his lips with a life coal from the altar, and may every word be God-breathed. We present before you those candidates for ordination today. Set them apart, we pray. Heavenly Father, just bless us. Guide us by your almighty hand. Guard us, we pray, and protect us from the evil forces. Provide for us not just this day, but every day. We surrender ourselves into your hands. We commit ourselves to your care. And prepare us, O God, for that place that you have gone to prepare for us. And Lord, we claim your promises now. We accept them now. And we live in you, always conscious that you're always with us, our guiding hand. We say thank you as we pray and ask these mercies in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. God is good. God, our God, is good. It is a great privilege to be in the house of the Lord. I'm going to invite the elders who are here, along with Pastors Walker and McLean, to join me up here. Two and a half years or so ago, we asks some members to serve as deaconesses. They accepted the invitation, and this morning, as a congregation, we want to present them to the Lord in dedication as they continue their service. There's no limit, Ellen White says, to the usefulness of one who, having set self aside, makes room for the workings of the Holy Spirit. As I spoke to one of the deaconesses this week, she said to me, "Pastor, I just want to do what God wants me to do. I take the responsibility seriously, and I want to do my very best." And I said, I couldn't ask for anything more. And neither could this congregation ask for anything more. Here are three wonderful ladies who have accepted the call to serve. They're being guided and shepherded by our head deaconess, Sister Beryl Stewart. So I'm going to invite Sister Shirley Payne to come, escorted by our head deaconess. Then, of course, she's being delivered over to our associate head elder, Elder McLean. Then, of course, we have Sister Judith Thompson. Sister Judith Thompson is a humble, God-fearing, pleasant member of our church. And then Sister Claudette McClintock. Sister Claudette McClintock is a believer in prayer. She just knows how to praise God. And we're just thankful that these three ladies have devoted themselves to the Lord, and that the Belvedere Seventh-day Adventist Church will be the better for their service. And I'm going to invite now Pastor Walker to come and share a word of charge, not monetary charge, but a spiritual charge.
All right, I'd like to just greet each of you warmly and sincerely in the precious name of Jesus. This is, for me, a very extraordinary moment. Ordination is no ordinary exercise. I believe that God is present in this moment in a special way. I won't be long, but the few words that I speak to you, I would ask that you remember this for the rest of your lives. When God touches time, it is extraordinary time. God entered the seventh day in a special way, and it will forever be holy. Holy time, God's time. When God touches a place, ordinary steel and mortar for us, for then it was of different material of wood and gold, the sanctuary, it became extraordinary. Ordinary men constructed it, but the moment the Spirit of God filled that place, it was no longer ordinary. And even the high priest could not enter the most holy place but once per year. It was extraordinary. When God touches a thing, it is no longer ordinary. He touched ordinary bush, and Moses had to remove the slippers from his feet because it was from there on extraordinary ground. Why? Because God specially touched that place. When God touches a person, he's no longer ordinary. He is forever forward extraordinary because of God's hand. When Samuel prophesied to Saul, he said to him, the Spirit will come upon you and you will be another man. Today you will be different from when you walked into this building, because God's hand would be upon you. And so I charge you to be conscious of the hand of the Almighty God, because he has another hand that he can touch with, and things will not be good thereafter. But today you have the good hand of God upon you. I want you to accept your ordination as not just an exercise that will make you simply proud. It is not just a call to a prestigious office. It's a call to a very extraordinary, a very important office. And God has written your agenda for you, and he has given you the Bible. You will serve not in servitude, but in servanthood. May the Spirit of God be upon you from this day forward.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Walker. One of the marks of the Seventh-day Adventist Church and Christians in general is one of understanding. This morning, we will not go the traditional route of asking the ordinance to kneel, because we need to be kind and considerate. And so we're going to ask not only the deaconesses who are being ordained to remain standing, but I'm going to invite the congregation, as you, in affirmation to this act of dedication, stand with us as we pray. At the appropriate time, the elders and pastors, we lay hands on you. Is that okay? Yes. Let's pray. Eternal God and our Heavenly Father, in this sacred space and sacred time, your people stand in solidarity as we set aside Claudette, Judith, and Shirley. They, God, have accepted your invitation through your church to serve your people. And Lord, as a congregation, we now set them aside. God, we pray that you would baptize them anew this morning with power from on high, that same power that descended on the ordinary men of Galilee on the day of Pentecost and transformed them into evangelists and apostles. Lord, may that Spirit now descend on these that we now set aside. May God, you always remind them in this moment of this moment that they are indeed servants of yours, called to serve your people. May their lives be representative of the call that you have placed on them, not only on Sabbaths, but every day of the week. Whether they're lying down at home or they're rising up, whether they're out at the store, wherever they are, may they be conscious of the fact that they represent you. We thank you, God, for their willingness to serve. May they serve always with distinction, never a mumbling word, just serving you in spirit and in truth. We thank you for them. We pray your blessing on them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. It is important for you also to remember this moment. So the church has and is granting you this certificate of ordination. Sister Judith. Sister Shirley Thomas Payne. And Sister Claudette McClintock. I want to say to Sister Shirley and Sister Judith and Sister Claudette that another member of our church who is functioning in her area of giftedness and calling is inviting you three to sit at a special table for lunch today in the fellowship hall. That special person is Sister Sylvia. Amen. Today is a special day for several individuals, and one of those individuals is Sister Natalie Lewis. Amen. Sister Lewis, happy birthday to you. May you have many, many more wonderful years. Keep on singing for the Lord and being a good wife to Michael. Amen. Amen. Now, tomorrow is another extraordinarily special day because Sister Walker was born about 35 years ago. So, Sister Walker, happy birthday to you, and that's endorsed by, now that you endorse it, you just opened the door. I didn't know you believe in child marriages, man, but that's all right, you don't have to defend yourself. I didn't know your age. Okay. This week also, Sister Marlene Davey. Sister Marlene celebrated her birthday this week. Brother Harvey Bryant and Marlon Cunningham and celebrated birthdays this week as well. And today, Sister Nadine Mundasir is celebrating her birthday as well. Tomorrow, we'll have our food pantry. We appreciate those members of our congregation who are working in that ministry. The director is away, but the program goes on. This weekend is the anniversary of Brother and Sister Edward. They're celebrating, I think, 20 years this weekend. So we wish Brother and Sister Edward happy anniversary. Now, Pastor Walker, would you come join me again? We concluded last Sabbath our guest services training, and you wanted to say something to the general congregation about how we will continue to do an outstanding job in connecting with our guests. So why don't you go right ahead and do that?
I'm excited. I don't know about you, but I see God moving in so many different ways. By the way, before I get into that, just a word out for our TMI, all departments. Just remember that in June we have our review. Everything that you said you would be accomplishing, we will just look at that to give you support as you carry on. Now, with regards to the primary greeters, ushers we have been working with, augmented by the ushers and deacons, we have strategized a full-bodied approach to our guest services, meaning all guests, everyone not a Belvedere member, once you come here, we want you to have the ultimate experience. We want to engage you in ways that will leave you with a high that God intended for you, and the blessings will just keep flowing and radiating throughout. And so from the parking lot to your leaving, we want to make sure that you are feeling at home, all our guests. Every member is involved in this because our greeters and ushers will be meeting our guests at any point of entry. We will have little tokens to show our appreciation. We will outline to them how we are open to making their lives here just a happy one, a very meaningful one, a spiritual one. And even when they come into the church, we want to make sure that they connect with a member. So our ushers, greeters will not just dump you off, as some people might want to think of it, but we will take you to your seats, introduce you to a member of the church who will greet you kindly. You will get to know persons as we get to know the Lord better as we worship here together. Upon leaving, we will make sure that you had a good time, and if there are any concerns, we will be happy to hear that, and we will endeavor to better what we do. We just want to make sure that we represent Christ in the right way. Jesus looked at persons as individuals and not just as a group for any other reason but to better the life of that person. So that's what we're trying to achieve here, and we are inviting every member. At a point, we're going to be speaking more specifically to our members. We will let you know specifically what we would like for each and every one of you to do, because it's one large team. Every member is a part of it. The pastors, we are dedicated to doing our part to make sure this happens. And even when the guests leave, if they should so desire, we will make sure we keep contact with them. Even if they never come back, we want to make sure that we don't abuse their trust in us. And we just pray that God will continue to bless us richly as we continue to serve in this regard. God bless you and thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. I was standing in the rear lobby this morning, and a beautiful young lady walked in and gave me a nice warm embrace. So, Camille, welcome home. Good to see you. Good to see you. Good to have you home. Good to have you home. Um, There is someone who has been with us for several weeks now, and that person is Mahalia Jones. Mahalia, would you stand? You've been hearing her name. We want you to stand, Mahalia. She's undergone her surgery. She's returning home on Tuesday of this coming week, and she wants us to know how much she appreciates the prayer ministry of this church. We lifted her up in prayer, and God has shown himself strong on her behalf. It's very rare. Thank you, Mary. It's very rare that you undergo surgery and a few days later the hospital and the doctor's office call you back or send you information that they owe you money. And that was what happened to Mahalia. They said, we have a 33% refund for you. Now, you know, that's good news. That translated into over $4,000, folks. Amen. So we're grateful for the success of the surgery. She's recovering nicely. She's still seeing still like men's walking like trees, but in a little while she's going to be seeing clearly, like Sil is seeing clearly. Amen. Because Sil underwent that similar surgery as well, and she's on the other side of it, and she's seeing all of us clearly. Thank you very much. She's also asking that we would lift her mother up in prayer as well. So let's lift Mahalia's mom up in prayer. We don't know the specifics of her request, but you know what? God knows. And when we pray, God does what he needs to do. Well, next Sabbath is a big kickoff Sabbath. What you say? Next Sabbath begins our spring series. It is important, and we've been talking about this. It's important for us to not only be in the sanctuary, but we're inviting our friends to be here. We are sending them the link for the service. And we want you to know that, yes, Pastor? Huh? Oh, the video? Oh, we have a video to play? All right. Thank you, Pastor. We'll just wait for the video to play right now. I'm going to stand over here so I can see it as well, even though it's over there. Sound would be nice. Sound would be nice. So let's go back and, okay. Sound would be nice. Pastor David Long is Sabbath School Personal Ministries Director for the Southern Union, Prison Ministries as well. And he will be our speaker. We begin at the 11 o'clock hour on next Sabbath. Then at 5
Happy
in
Sabbath,
the afternoon.
Belvedere.
Here we go.
This is Pastor David Long, and I am grateful for the opportunity to be your guest speaker for the Restoration Now Revival. I know that you are now preparing and getting ready for this great event, Restoration Now. May God help all of us to prepare for this grand event taking place on March the 25th. We're beginning that Saturday night at 7 o'clock p.m. May God help us all to be ready for that day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, I just need to correct that. It's at 5, not 7. 5 on Sabbath evening, 5 on Sunday evening. Then of course, we go Wednesday, and then Friday, Sabbath, Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And we will end on April 8th with a baptism. Amen. We already have several individuals who have signed up, and you don't want to miss out on this. If you're not yet baptized, if you have a friend that you've been working with and praying for, this is a time to invite them to come, because we know that God has something extraordinarily special for every person. So let's get that on our schedule. Let's be here every night for these next 2 weeks. Today, we have with us Dr. Errol McLean. He is working currently with the North American Division Evangelism Institute, otherwise known to us as NADI. His wife is also here with him. So we're going to ask Sister McLean to stand so you all can see her. They've been in ministry now for a long time, he says. It's so long he can hardly remember the number of years, but it's been a long time. But God is renewing his strength on a daily basis. We're so happy that Dr. McLean is at NADI and he's here with us today. And he will share with us not only the sermon this morning, but he has some extra goodies for us in the afternoon. So right after our Bible class at 4, he will do a presentation on how to make friends easier. A lot of us, we've grown up with the idea, don't talk to strangers, but strangers can become friends if you know how. So we're inviting you to be back for that so that we can have all of the tools with which to make our spring series and ongoing series a great success. Today, again, we have the privilege of returning to God our tithes and our offerings. God has been so good to us. He has blessed us on a daily basis. In fact, the reason we're here today is because God has blessed us. And so in appreciation for God's blessing, we want to return to him that which is his and also a freewill offering in proportion to his blessing. And so this morning, we're reminding ourselves that our tithe is designated by God and the offering is based on his blessing towards us. The tithe is numerical, the offering is qualitative. So give a quality offering to the Lord in appreciation for his blessings to you this morning. While we do that, we will be blessed with special music by Sister Anita. Anita, we're waiting. Come on over and bless our hearts as we wait.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me. Ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear these burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, Jesus will help me, Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. He is a kind, compassionate friend. If I but ask him, he will deliver. Make of my troubles quickly an end. I must tell Jesus. Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus will help me, Jesus alone. Oh, how the world to evil allures me. Oh, how my heart is tempted to sin.
Let's bow our heads together. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gifts that have been given. We thank you, God, for blessing your people with life and health and strength and employment. We thank you for their faithfulness. May these tithes and offering go to advance your work, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just before we do our theme song and we invite Dr. McLean to come and share with us, there is a special Mother's Day event that is coming up. It is being sponsored by someone that we know here at Belvedere very well. It is a fundraiser for a mission trip to Ghana. And we hope that you will support that to the degree that you can. Over the next several weeks, we'll have details in terms of how you can secure meaningful entrance into this event, and know that the proceeds will be going to a good place for a good cause. And so, Yvonne, are you here? Yvonne Dunkley, are you here? All right, Yvonne is not here, but just wanted you to know and be aware of that, and we'll provide you additional information as the weeks go by. Sister Natalie, come lead us into our theme song.
Let us all stand, please.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. No one else can take your place to feel.
Amen. Isn't God good? Isn't God good? What an awesome God we serve. I want to invite you, God, you're so good to us. And none of us here can say we deserve it. It's but by your grace. Give us today an encounter with you, an experience that would leave us awed. In the glory and in the presence of God is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. Praise the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. It is certainly my pleasure to be here with you today in Belvedere. I can tell you I've heard about Belvedere for quite a while. I'm just glad to be able to be here for the first time. And some of you might be saying, well, where were you all this time? It's just wonderful to be with you in worship. And I can tell you, I enjoyed the worship so far. You know, I commend it to the pastors. And this is a church that people seem happy. You know, they're laughing, they're smiling, they're praising God. You know, it is good to feel that spirit. You know, there are some churches you go there, think you're on Animal Farm. You know, people are looking sad and drab, but you are looking happy and excited to be in God's presence. I was also commended to your book, to two pastors, you know, that I saw something happen, because I've been to many churches. You know, we have those churches back then, we used to have a lot of bulletins before COVID. You know, you see a long list of people to pray for. And some of those churches, people have been healed and they're in church, but their name stays on the list. But this morning I came here and the pastor was just giving God thanks for what God is doing in people's lives. Healing them, giving them back money. I think I need to. Pastor, do you have any space on your membership list for me? God is good. And when we come to worship, we come to celebrate that God is active in our lives. Because if God ain't active, why are we here? If God's doing nothing, why are we here? But if God is involved, we can say praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise Him, praise Him. I want to thank Dr. Bulgin and Dr. Walker and your church for the invitation to be here with you today. I am certainly glad for the experience to be here. As my wife got up earlier, and we're just happy that she's here with me as well. We go back some ways, Dr. Bulgin and Dr. Walker and myself. You know, we go back, I guess, birthplace. We all were born in the same little island in the Caribbean. And Dr. Walker and myself went to the same church as kids together. And we lived in, you know, nearby each other. We were friends for a while. And then we pastored together in West Jamaica Conference. And then we pastored with Dr. Bulgin in Bermuda together, where he was our president in Bermuda. So, you know, we go back a while. And so I'm just glad to be able to join him here today. Praise God. This is actually the second time, I'm actually preaching in Atlanta. You know, many years ago, when I was pastoring in Bermuda, I preached in Berean, Atlanta, when Bill Winston was a pastor there, and he invited me over, and I preached there for him. And at the time, my mother-in-law, my wife is from Bermuda. She left all of Bermuda. I left Bermuda. And we came, and my mother-in-law, I never forgot, Elder Winston said, you know, this man must be special. His mother-in-law came to hear him preach. Well, I didn't get my mother-in-law to come to preach with me today, but I got her sister to come to be with me today. So, Aunt Jackie, it's good to see you. Praise God. Amen. And she was brought by her granddaughter. And so, Ericky and Riley, we're just thankful that you're here. So, I got family in Atlanta. Praise God. Praise God. It's a good place to be. Well, I would like to chit-chat a little more, but I won't take my time to do that. That's not what God sent me to do. My message today is between a rock and a hard place. Anybody ever been between a rock and a hard place? It's the kind of place you don't want to be. Am I right? Between a rock and a hard place. That is a difficult place indeed to be. But whether you are between a rock and a hard place or not, God knows how to be there with you. In Exodus chapter 33, Exodus, second book of the Bible, chapter 33, I'm going to read from verse 17. And you can read it in whatever version you have. I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation because that's what is on my tablet right now. It says, "The Lord replied to Moses, 'I will indeed do what you have asked, for I look favorably on you, and I know your name.' Moses responded, 'Then show me your glory.'" Show me your glory. "The Lord replied, 'I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will call out my name, Yahweh, before you. For I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose." Somebody say amen. "But you may not look directly at my face, for no one may see me and live." The Lord continued, "Look, stand near me on this rock, and my glory will pass by. And I will hide you in the cleft, in the crevice of the rock, and cover you with my hand until I have passed. Then I will remove my hand, and you will see me from the back." That's what God said. Indeed, that's what God said. Now, between a rock and a hard place, but I just want to talk a little bit about God's glory first. You know, what is God's glory? Well, what is, to us as human, what is glory? I was reflecting on this and I thought, how do you feel about yourself? I don't know, most of us here, many of us, all of us, some of us are perhaps dressed today in some new brand name stuff, outfit. You had your hair done, you had your face done, cuticles are trimmed up, some of the ladies are smiling. Your brows are all done, neat, trimmed. Even eyelashes these days you can get done. You are accessorized in ways to hide your deficits and to flaunt your assets. You are looking good and you know it. You are even feeling good about yourself. You may feel like a king or a queen, and you're preening like a peacock. And so sometimes we sense that, you know, as humans, that our glory is what we look like. How we dress, what we have, where we live. Coming up in a few weeks, I think, it will be the coronation of King Charles. And the glory of the royalty is the crown and the crown jewelry. And so when King Charles is, they have his coronation, we will see the glory of the king. It will be on display, the royal jewelry. There will be pomp and ceremony. A golden horse-drawn carriage. There will be the traditional gun salute. But it will all be an outward show. Maybe I'm the only one here not really impressed by human outward display of pomp and circumstances. I remember when Princess Diana and Charles, you remember him, her and him together, when they got married. I remember when Kate and William got married. You know, and people were getting up early morning. Some of you guys maybe who came from, you know, past colonial countries, getting up early to see their wedding. You know, I thought, I mean, they didn't come to see mine. Why should I get up to see theirs? But people like to be where there is pomp and circumstance and ceremony, where glory is on display. I took the time to check in the Webster and the Merriam dictionary, you know, some synonyms for self-glory. Talked about personal vanity, pride, synonyms such as ego, big head, conceit, swell-headedness, self-opinionated, self-importance. So I'm going to ask you to wonder about something with me. I will muse about it loudly, and you will do so quietly. Except if it speaks to you personally, just say, ouch. When you dressed for church this morning, how many of you were thinking, this outfit is for God's glory? Any ouch? Instead, you know, we're human. Maybe you're like me, thinking, man, I look good in this. I look good in this. I know there are some saints here who never had a sinful thought, so you're quiet. But for the rest of us, just say, ouch. And so we live and dress to show our self-glory and even our self-sufficiency. Like the Pharisees, we can enter the temple robed in our self-importance to engage in personal self-commendation. But Jesus calls us today, yes, he does, not to have a show off our self-glory, but instead to be like that publican who recognizes his filthy rags, bowed before God in humility and cried out in desperation, God, Forgive me. I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. And so going back to this story we read about Moses in Exodus, Moses grew up in the glory of the Egyptian palace. That's what he grew up in. He saw Pharaoh's glory every day. Yet, he only recorded his experience of God's glory in Exodus chapter 32 through to chapter 34. And so we're going to take a brief look at 3 points to understand what it means to experience God's glory. And the first point I labeled, when it feels too much. When it feels too much. You see, Moses had an invitation from God. And so he ascended the mount. He was up there for many days, over 40 days. He was up there in God's presence. He spent a few days before waiting for God to invite him fully. He was up there with Joshua. And so for the second half of that period, or the second portion of that period, he left Joshua and fully entered into God's presence. And while he was there, in Exodus chapter 32, you can read it later on. While he was there, God told Moses, get back down off this mountain because the people, Moses, that you led out of Egypt, they are down there doing some stuff. They are worse off than the Egyptians. And Moses felt so discouraged. I remember many years ago, I was pastor at a church in Jamaica. And I went over to Bermuda, got married, came back with my wife. Came back with my beautiful wife. Went to a church and we were having communion service. What more could a pastor ask for? The first Sabbath, I came back with my beautiful wife into Jamaica, and we were having this communion. And after the communion, 2 members got a fight in the front yard of the church right before everybody. I felt like I would pack up and go home. I said, God, it's too much. You know, you're pouring out everything. And so that's how Moses felt. Like, after all of that, God, after all of that glory up on the mountain, it felt too much. And some of us, as people are worshiping the golden calf, some of us feel like Moses. In our faith journey, we have dealt, some of us, with angry pharaohs. Maybe you have dealt with the Egyptian army. We have endured wilderness experiences. We have had times of hunger and thirst. We have coped with difficult situations and circumstances. And we have, even like Moses was, we have been separated from our families. And sometimes people see you going through your difficulties and they commend you for how strong you are. But you know, you're not as strong as you seem. Have you ever had that happen? And I like how you deal with that. And you know, if they even touch you, you'd start to cry. I think you're strong, but you know deep in your hearts you're not that strong. Instead, you're thinking, I can't take it anymore. And so this is what happened to Moses. After 40 days of prayer and fasting, he had heard from God. He was feeling pretty strong and confident. He had even had the 10 commandments in stone coming back to the people in his hand. But what happened next was too much for him. Here was Aaron, his own brother, his own flesh and blood, leading Israel to worship a golden idol in rebellion against God. Moses was so angry that he threw the stone tablet with the 10 commandments down. This felt like this betrayal left Moses feeling so broken, so abandoned, Israel had rejected him. And when he needed it most, Moses even feel that not even God was standing up with me. Have you ever felt like that? I want to tell you, when I ask you, have you ever felt like that? I hope you're reflecting. Because, I know some of us as Christians, I'm too blessed to be stressed. Yeah, you're right. We are people that God made. And I tell you, sometimes I become so discouraged about my church. I become so discouraged about people. And then God turned me back to the Bible. And when I read the Bible, I said, God, we've always been like this. We've always been like this. Sometimes I look in the church, pastor, I see the politics that we play. And then I read about, Saul almost killed his own son to stay on the throne. So when has it changed? God is just saying, that's how you all are. But I'm here for you. And so somebody is here today feeling just like Moses. You are perhaps feeling depressed, broken, angry. You're feeling misunderstood by your family, your friends, and even your church. All your good times with God are now in the rearview mirror. Right now, things are getting worse, and you're feeling all alone. So what do you do when you feel like this? That's where we go to our second point. What do you do when you feel so broken, so depressed? Depression seems to be a common byproduct of breathing these days. Everybody is depressed. Everybody is getting counsel. Everybody has a shrink. Everybody has their foot up on the couch. But before Moses walked away from God, even though he felt somehow as if God had turned his back on him, you know what Moses did? He turned to God and started to complain. I used to read the Bible and think, it's an act of lack of faith to complain to God. But then I discovered that God don't mind you complain. Let me say that again. God don't mind when you come complaining to him. As long as you come complaining to him in authenticity and you're prepared to listen when he answers you. And so Moses was like this, God, I don't know what else you expect me to do. Anybody? I'm here just trying to serve you the best way I can, but all I get is more trouble. I don't know what else you expect me to do. Moses felt like God didn't have his back. So I look through the Bible and I find all kind of people complain. In fact, Jeremiah was called a weeping prophet. That's why he wrote the book of Lamentation. You know what is a lament? And so complaining to God like Moses, God, you say you know my name and you favor me, but you expect me to lead these people by myself? Or like Job. Job says, I'm disgusted with my life, so I will complain to God. And then he told God, don't just condemn me. Tell me what charges you have against me. And even David, in Psalm 64, David said, listen to me, God. Let me complain to you. And so here's the silver lining to complaining to God. Anytime you're talking to God, even if you're complaining, he's listening. Don't tell. Sometimes you tell it to a friend. And they want to advise you. I got a headache. And your friend is telling you, okay, if you had a headache, here's what you do. And they're giving you some bush medicine, some things that your grandma 10 years, before when they were children used to do. Well, if it worked for you, it's not going to work for me. They think because it worked for them, it will work for you. But here's the point I'm making. Don't go to others and you haven't gone to God. Tell the complaints to God. Anytime you're talking to God, even if you're complaining, I say he is listening. And if you are ready to engage with God, he will be right back at you. You remember when you were kids? And even if you think your parents didn't treat you right, you couldn't complain to them? Like, what are you complaining for? You want another one? You remember that? But with God, he doesn't threaten you. He's patient. He listens to you. He reaches out to answer your cry. Moses complained as if he didn't trust God. It was like, God, with all I'm going through, I don't even know if you have my back. In fact, I don't know if you are able to even make a difference right now. I will only believe it if you show me your glory. I will only believe it if you show me your glory. And it is not, I want you to follow me now. It is not as if Moses hadn't seen God's glory before. Moses' first encounter, Dr. Walker, he encountered God as the I am that I am at the burning bush. Who ever seen a bush burning but not burning? He had witnessed all the wonders associated with God's deliverance of Israel from Egypt, including the parting of the Red Sea. I mean, some people say that the parting of the Red Sea happened by some natural forces. Maybe an earthquake caused a fault in the earth that backed up the river. But when it happened, when you need it, it's God. Moses saw the pillar of cloud and fire that led Israel along their journey. He observed the stunning natural signs of God's presence on Mount Sinai. Yet here he was saying, God, show me your glory. How would you expect God to respond when Moses said, God, show me your glory? How would you expect God to respond? Anybody ever ask you a question yet and you don't know how to respond? Like you look at them and your mouth open and no words coming out. Like, what should I say? Could it be like the disciples? You know, once Jesus walked through a Samaritan village and the Samaritans rejected Jesus. And so the disciples asked Jesus, Jesus, show them your glory. Lord, show these good for nothing people who just rejected you your glory. Yes, Jesus, why don't you just send some fire from heaven and zap them? Zap, zap, zap. That will impress them. That will teach them to reject you. Those were some really bloodthirsty disciples, weren't they? I mean, they were asking Jesus to take revenge by using his power and his glory to murder all the people in the villages. They got Jesus wrong, didn't they? Ellen White says, when Moses went on Mount Sinai to receive the law, the mountain was covered in thick cloud and the glory of God broke out like a devouring fire. So when Moses asked to see God's glory, could it be that Moses was also requesting God to send down fire like at the burning bush to zap the Israelites for daring to make and worship a golden idol? After all that God did to take them out of Egypt, this is how you repay him? Don't they all deserve God? Don't they all deserve some holy fireworks to burn the disobedience out of them? Moses might be saying, God, show them what you can do so they won't mess with you again. There's a quick little story in the Bible of Gideon. Gideon, one night just before God called him, Gideon destroyed the altar of Baal. And so when the Israelites who worshiped Baal heard that the altar was destroyed, they came to Gideon's father the next morning. Says, we heard that one of your sons destroyed the temple of the God we worship, Baal. Send him out here so we can take care of him. And Gideon's dad says, if Baal is any kind of God, why don't he defend himself? Why do you guys think you need to defend him? And I'm saying that because too often some of us think we need to defend God. So somebody makes a mistake and we want God to send fire and lightning down from heaven and destroy them. I heard a story a few weeks ago of a church that was going to be beginning some meetings, revival series like you're beginning. And they went out into the neighborhood and they were knocking on doors, and they knocked on a door and a young black lady answered the door. And they invited her to their church that they were having. And she says, what church is that? And they said, it is a Seventh-day Adventist church around the corner. And when she heard the word Seventh-day Adventist church, she told them, leave my door and never come back here again. And they asked her why. And she said, I grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist in one of the islands. When I was a teenager, I got pregnant. And when I needed my church the most was when they called on fire from God out of heaven and got rid of me. Notice what Moses asked for. God's glory. Notice what God showed up, how God showed up to show his glory. And so here's another ouch. Like the disciples or like Moses, could it be that sometimes we don't get God? We have no idea what his glory means. We primarily understand God's glory as his means of punishing people. I remember many years ago, I watched this movie called The Raiders of the Lost Ark. Anybody ever saw that? I know how fascinated I was when what we call the Shekinah came down. Wrapped itself around the ark. They had this light thing demonstrating. And so sometimes when we think of God's glory, we're looking for lightning and thunder and pyrotechnic display. Maybe God's means of punishing people. Somebody does something wrong and God will just zap them on the spot, like he did when those two men touched the Ark of the Covenant. That's what we expect when many of us think of God's glory. And so when another believer fails in a different way from how we fail, we all get offended for God and we take it on ourselves to defend God's glory, so we don't pray for them anymore. Instead, our default is to kick them out of the church. We don't call them like we used to do anymore. Instead, we pretend we don't see them when we pass them in the grocery store. In fact, we hope that God will show off his glory and zap them. But God wanted Moses to learn one key thing. It is that even when we are between a rock and a hard place, God doesn't give up on anybody. As long as you are engaged with him, he stands by you. He connects with you and extends his grace towards you. And so God said, I will make my glory. I will make my goodness. Moses says, God, show me your glory. And God says, Moses, you want to see my glory? Here it is. I will make my goodness pass before you. That's my glory. It's my goodness. Our glory is not what we know. Our glory is not how we dress. Our glory is not a knowledge of the Sabbath. Our glory is not whether we eat vegetarian or not. Our glory is not whether or not we are vegan. All those things we can do, but we can't leave undone that our glory is the goodness of God. That's our glory. God said, I will make my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim to you my name, the Lord, and I will be gracious. And I want to say something, beloved. I began to understand that the more I consider how good God has been to me, it's the more it makes me appreciate his grace to other people as well. Because if I think I saved myself, if I think I could be good enough, if I think I could keep the Sabbath good enough to be saved, then I would expect everybody else to do the same. But when I know that God, as good as I keep the Sabbath, I can't be good enough to keep it to be saved. As much as I don't eat meat, I can't not eat meat, not enough to be saved. I'm just saved by your grace. And when I understand God's grace to me, it makes me gracious to other people. Are you hearing me this morning? Jesus says, the Bible says, and they'll know we are his people by our love, by how gracious we are to each other. To the person who fails, to the person who strays, to the person who is weak, to the person who makes mistake. That's what he wants us to see, his glory. He said, Moses, you can't see my face, for no man can see my face and live, but I'm going to put you between a rock and a hard place. And then I will pass by. And I will cover you with my hands until I've passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you will see my back, but my face shall not be seen. When you look at it in the Hebrew, it could almost be translated, you will see my reward. You will see what comes after. Let me say that again. You will see the after effect. And so in Exodus chapter 34, verse 6 to 9, so God says, this is what I'm going to do. So in Exodus 34 now, verse 6 to 9, it happened. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, merciful. Who is God? He's merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sins, by no means clearing the guilty. He visits the iniquity of the father upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. So when Moses heard that, he made haste and bowed his head towards the earth and worshipped. Then he said, if I have found grace in your sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray you, go with us, your people. If I have found grace in your sight. Let me help you with that. Moses started complaining to God when he found himself in a hard place. Israel had quickly disobeyed God after coming out of Egypt, rejected Moses, made a golden idol as their false god to take them back to Egypt. Moses was so discouraged that he said to God, I don't want to do this anymore. It's okay with me if you show off your glory by sending down hellfire and destroying all these people. So God told Moses, you can only see my glory if you stand between the cleft of the rock, then I will cover you while I'm passing by, and you will see my back. So Moses stood between a rock and a hard place, waiting to see a dazzling display of God's Shekinah glory, like the thunder and the smoke and the fire and the lightning that God displayed on Mount Sinai. He waited there in awe
for God's glory to break out and to destroy the sinful, disobedient people. But as God passed by, there was no pyrotechnic display of God's power and judgment on the wicked. What Moses experienced instead was a new sense of God, that when you are between a rock and a hard place, our God is merciful. Our God is gracious. Our God is long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin. I am not sure that Moses was expecting this, but I am sure this is what God wanted him to know. That even as sinful as Israel was between a rock and a hard place, 2 Peter 3 verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering to all of us, not willing that any should perish. You know what that any mean? That any mean the person you didn't talk to this week that you don't like. I don't know who you think is the wickedest person you've ever heard about in the world. Maybe Hitler? I remember when we were growing up in the Caribbean, we used to name all the bad dogs Castro. So maybe it's, I don't know who you thought, but whoever it is, God loved them just as much as he loves you. His grace is just as much for them as it is for any single one of us. That's the God. His grace is for the Sunday keepers. His grace is for the Sabbath keepers. His grace is amazing. You didn't save yourself. You couldn't save yourself if you tried a million years. It's God. He is patient, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. When you know God like that, what people see next about you is what comes afterward. So we're talking about the after effect. After God passes by, what you see is the after effect. The Hebrews in Exodus 33 says, God told Moses, you can't see my face, but you will see my back. What you will see is the afterward, the after effect. This can be understood as seeing what comes after. It may be a metaphor for what follows after my face. That is the after effect. So when you have experienced an authentic divine encounter with God, there is an after effect. You can't remain the same. Something happens to you. Something must change in you. Something different now. That's what God is talking about. A change comes over you. Moses, who was angry and complaining, ready for God to kill all Israel, yet he engaged and had an encounter with God. The after effect of his glimpse into the heart of God led him to bow in worship. And so he then asked God to draw near to his people, to pardon their iniquity and to make them his own. Amen. And so every day, I'm understanding more and more that even though I was born in sin, shaped in iniquity, even though I fall short of the glory of God, yet when I see into the heart of God and understand the power of his amazing grace to me, that to me, he is the Lord merciful and gracious. He is the Lord long-suffering and abundant in love and understanding. Then my face, when I understand that, begins to shine and I can bow in worship. It also changes how I treat others. For I now understand that God, who is so gracious to me, is not angrily wanting to destroy others, but lovingly seeking to forgive them and save them as he saved me from between a rock and a hard place. And so God's glory is not the Shekinah. It's not a Technicolor light show or a 4th of July first-class fireworks. Here it is. God's glory is his goodness. God's glory is his love. God's glory is his marvelous, amazing grace. And when we, like Moses, experience God's glory, God's goodness, God's love, God's amazing grace, it will leave its after effect on you, for it changes you, and your faces, like Moses' face, will begin to glow. We'll begin to glow from that encounter with God. Our lives will glow with hope that we never imagined and joy that we have never experienced. And so God wants you to know that when your soul is hungry, when your tank is empty, when you're running on fumes, when you feel like giving up, when you feel like letting go, ask for God's help. Just say, God, show me your glory. And then the after effect will fill you up. It's the after effect of your encounter with God that will change you. It's the after effect of your time with God that changes your complaining to confessing. It's the after effect of your confidence in God that delivers you from between a rock and a hard place. It's the after effect of waiting on God that moves you from protest to praise and from worrying to worship. Is there anybody here today who desperately wants an encounter with God? You came here today wanting to experience God's glory. When last has God turned up and showed off in your life? You have never experienced a burning bush or a pillar of fire. So I'm asking you today, do you want an experience with God? Do you want an experience with God? Do you want to see his glory? Well, here it is. Philip said to Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and that's all right with us. And Jesus said, Philip, have I been so long with you? And you still don't know me? Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen God. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The glory of God today is here, fully embodied in Jesus. To see Jesus is to see more than Moses saw on the mount. You didn't get that. I think that went right over your head. So let me say it again. To see Jesus, you would see more than Moses saw when Moses was on the mount. And you're asking then, how will I see Jesus? Well, here it is, John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with, and the Word was God. Verse 14, that Word is full of grace and truth. We can see Jesus in the words of the Scriptures. Too often we read the Bible for knowledge, but we should be reading the Bible for God to change us. I don't read the Bible so I could show off in Sabbath school or show off in the Bible study class that I know everything. No, when we read the Bible, we are trying to see Jesus. When we talk about the Sabbath, we are trying to say, here is Jesus. When we talk about the commandments, we are trying to say, here is Jesus. I would see Jesus. God's glory is seen in Jesus. He is the full expression of the glory of God. And so I close by this appeal. God, show us your glory. Colossians 2:9, in him the whole fullness of the deity dwells bodily in Jesus. And so appealing to us as Adventists, those who like Moses are begging to see God's glory. And we presuppose before God shows up that his glory is lightning and thunder with smoke and ashes. So we look in God's law and we see words to be kept by our human efforts. Well, today I want you to hear me now. God is saying his glory is in Jesus Christ. It is abundant love and amazing grace. So when you read the word, see Jesus. When you ask yourself how I should treat people, see Jesus. When you ask yourself how I should worship on Sabbath, see Jesus. When you ask yourself what it means not to kill and not to steal, see Jesus. Be like the Supreme Court judges. You know, they interpret the law. Jesus is the best Supreme Court judge we could ever ask for. He interprets the law so we know what it means. The Sabbath don't mean to be unkind to others. The Sabbath doesn't mean to be miserable around others. Being a Seventh-day Adventist doesn't mean that we just keep the law and we hold the Bible under our armpits and we're more holy than others. What the Sabbath means is to look to Jesus and see how Jesus treats others. That's how we're going to treat them. That's the glory of God. He treated people with love. He treated people with grace. That's how God expects us to be. For he created us human beings, not human doings. It's who we are in Jesus. And so when you read and see Jesus, and we see him as truth and grace, truth and grace, truth and grace, not as theoretical head knowledge to show off, but as a personal experience to have, to interpret through scriptures. Every day, ask Jesus, Lord, how can I be like you more and more? God is not calling us to know him more. He's calling us to be him more. That is to be more like him. He is the glory of God. And so the song says, as I close, let this be our prayer today. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pouring out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Lord, don't just open our heads for knowledge. Open our hearts. We want to be like Jesus. Is there somebody here today who would just love to want to be like Jesus? Won't you just raise your hand where you are? Praise God. Praise God. And maybe as we close now, there's somebody here who you raised your hand, but you want to make that commitment. Let's make a commitment today. We begin next week the spring revival. Today is a good time for us to see the glory of God demonstrated in our own lives, in love and grace. And so, won't you stand with me if you want to make that commitment? Lord, we want to be like Jesus. We want to be like Jesus. I want to be like Jesus. Lord, help me to be like Jesus. Thank you for standing with me. What a commitment. What a commitment this morning. And maybe there's somebody here who has not yet, you know, seal that commitment through baptism. And I know that in a few weeks, there will be baptisms. But you can begin to prepare for that even now by making a commitment today. That the pastors and the evangelists to come, he's not calling you just to be a Seventh-day Adventist. They're calling you to be like Jesus. That's what we want, to be like Jesus. And if there's somebody here today who you have not yet sealed that commitment, but you want to be like Jesus, to be baptized like a marriage, married to Jesus, that you would be like Jesus in every way. And you'd like today to say, just pray for me as I make that commitment. Just raise your hand where you are. Anyone. Anyone. Praise God. Anybody else. Just, you don't have to keep it up. Just raise it and drop it. I see that hand. I want to pray for you. I'm going to pray that God will bless you. I'm going to come down here and I'm going to ask if you desire, you just like to come and stand beside me so I can pray with you quickly. I would love to pray with you before I go. Anybody. I want to be like Jesus. And you'd like me to pray with you. Just come down here. Let's pray. Let's pray. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. What a good God. Put your hands together for what God is doing. This is a church I came in this morning. You were celebrating what God is doing. And God is so good today. God is so good today. What a God we serve. What a God we serve. Open the eyes of our heart, Lord. We would see Jesus. God bless you, my son. God bless you. Amen. 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 God is good. Dr. Bulgin, you want to lead us in prayer, please? Want to lead us in prayer as we just pray for these individuals that are here?
We're going to do that just as we have Natalie. Would you sing that song, I'd Rather Have Jesus? Come on and sing that song.
Well, the song is being sung. Maybe somebody else wants to come.
Yeah.
If somebody else wants to come, we're going to just sing this song, and then we're going to have a special prayer for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Maybe others are standing with you in support, but we want to pray for them. And if somebody else wants to join them while the song is being sung, come now would be a good time.
I'd rather have Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Than sin. Of rare
Father in heaven, we're so grateful that you are enough for all of us. We stand, Lord, in your presence right now, wanting to be changed, wanting to be transformed, wanting a closer relationship with you. We want to be glorified by your presence. And Lord, we are so grateful today that you want to fill us with all of your fullness. We thank you, God, for those who have come forward in response to the invitation. We are thankful, Lord, for those of us who are standing also in response to the invitation to have more of you. Lord, we know that you are not only interested in us right now, you're interested in us for eternity. And Lord, as we give ourselves to you, we know we're giving ourselves over to the one who loves us deeply, and the one who is preparing a place for us, and the one who will come back to receive us to himself. And so, Lord, we just praise you and we thank you. And we pray that your will continue to be done, that when we stand between a rock and a hard place, we'll not look for ourselves to be broken, but that we will look for opportunities to serve others and see you in your fullness. Thank you, God, for all that you have done. Thank you for what you're doing right now and what you will do. And now we say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and always. And let all of God's people say, amen and amen. Thank you for coming. God bless you. God bless you.